Hola, buenos días a todos. Hoy es el día de Santa Brígida, el día para celebrar las mujeres. Good morning, everybody. After that short video, I wanted to welcome you all to our St. Bridget's Day event today of the Irish Embassy in here in Bogota. I am Alison Milton, Ireland's ambassador to Colombia. A huge honor to hold this position on this very, very special day. Happy St. Bridget's Day to you all. Or as we say in Irish, Lá Féile Bhríde, Sona Ghuibh Gualair. I want to say a very special word of welcome to all our Irish citizens here in Colombia and in Panama that are accompanying us today. I hope that today's event helps you feel a little bit more connected to home during these difficult times. Today, as well as being St. Bridget's Day, for us in Ireland, is also the first day of spring. And with spring comes new hope. I also want to give a very special welcome to all of our Colombian friends. Muy bienvenidos aquí a este evento. Y si quieren escucharlo en español, solo es escoger el botón de interpretación o language interpretation. The event will be mainly in English, but of course, please do accompany us in whichever language you wish. For those of you who don't know, St. Bridget is the only female patron saint of Ireland. And we have three of them. She was a Celtic figure who lived, we reckon, around the 5th century. And she led an extraordinary life as a popular religious leader, a talented writer, a healer, an educator, and a peacemaker. February 1st, today, is her Saint's Day. And a special wish to all the people in the world that are called Bridget, as that this is their Saint's Day. And this day for us has come to represent hope, renewal, fertility, and above all, a strong sense of femininity. St. Bridget was also a woman who rejected the conventions of her time. She was a trailblazer in the truest sense of the word. And in its modern form, St. Bridget's Day is a celebration of all those carrying on Bridget's legacy as a pioneer. It is a great time to celebrate female visionaries like Bridget, who broke through barriers and who forged a new path despite all adversity. Last year was the first year we celebrated St. Bridget's Day as the Embassy of Ireland in Bogota, and we held an event, a fabulous event in Cartagena, which I'm sure all of you know very well, in conjunction with the Hay Festival, featuring Irish novelist Mary Costello, who I think might be accompanying us today as well, so big hello, Mary, and the very talented Irish-Colombian singer Katie James, who we're so lucky to have with us here again this year. We also organized a lecture in the National University here in Bogota with Mary Costello, telling people a little bit about women's journey in Ireland. It was a perfect combination of events, really, because St. Bridget's Day is all about arts, creativity, and femininity. Now today, unfortunately, we can't meet in person. We can't all go to Cartagena or have a nice event here in the residence in Bogota, but we really wanted to celebrate this day, and we took the opportunity to invite three incredible Irish female trailblazers to join us virtually, to tell us about their own experiences in breaking through barriers in the areas that they've worked in and the challenges that they've had to face in order to achieve all that they did. As ambassador, I'm very lucky to be able to choose the people that we invite to our events. And today I took the liberty to invite three women who have inspired me personally, who helped me understand that it is possible to succeed and it is possible to fulfill your dreams while still maintaining balance in your life. These three ladies have broken through glass ceilings, paving the way for those of us who followed. Let me now introduce our three panelists. First, we have Mary Harney. Mary, it's so nice to have you with us, joining us from Ireland. Mary has held cabinet positions in Ireland for 18 years, including 10 years as a minister for health. And she was Ireland's first female Tánaiste, which is our deputy prime minister, and the first ever female leader of a political party in Ireland. She retired from politics in 2011, and in 2018 was appointed Chancellor of the University of Limerick. And I also know that Mary visited Colombia last year and passed the New Year's into 2020 here with us in Colombia. That was her first time visiting. Secondly, I'm going to introduce Anne Anderson, who is our Ambassador of Ireland to the United States from 2013 to 2017, the first woman to occupy that position. Anne also served as Ireland's Ambassador to the United Nations in New York, our Ambassador to France, our Ambassador to the European Union, and Ambassador to the United Nations in Geneva. Anne has broken many glass ceilings for us female diplomats, has really been a fantastic role model for us. She retired in 2017, but of course, again, like Mary, is not idle by any means. She's currently chair of the UN Peacebuilding Fund, which we know is very important here in Colombia. And Anne has visited Colombia twice in that role with the Peacebuilding Fund. I also highly recommend reading her new book, Thinking with My Pen, which she published last year, which shares with us some of Anne's reflections on life and her speeches from her life in diplomacy. Finally, today, we have with us Mary Lawlor. Unfortunately, Mary will be joining us just a few minutes late, but we're so delighted to have Mary. She's the current UN Special Rapporteur for Human Rights Defenders and has a long and impressive career in defending human rights. She founded the very important NGO Frontline Defenders in 2001 and was the chairperson and then director of the Irish section of Amnesty International from 1983 to 2000. Mary has been a relentless defender of human rights, and we were so proud to see her appointed to her current Special Rapporteur role. And I know that so many people here in Colombia were really pleased to see Mary appointed to that role, given that this is such an important issue for Colombia. So there are three panelists. We're also going to have music from the fabulously talented Katie James, who, as I mentioned, participated last year in Cartagena with us, St. Bridget's Day. Katie, who was born in Ireland and who's really lived her whole life in Colombia, but has been such a good friend to this embassy since we opened. Katie will play two songs for us relevant to the theme of today's discussion, an Irish one and a Latin American one, and one halfway through and one at the end. And it's so good to have you here again, Katie. Finally, given that our three panelists are such extraordinary women, we needed to find a moderator who was just as extraordinary. I know most of our audience will already know Claudia Palacios, a renowned journalist, writer, and broadcaster. Claudia, muchísimas gracias por estar aquí con nosotros hoy. Es un gran, gran honor tenerla aquí. Thanks so much for agreeing to moderate today's discussion, Claudia. And I really want to thank everybody who has joined us here today. I think that we have well over 50, 60 participants now, and I'm sure we'll have many more. So please, if you have any questions for our panelists during the discussion, just put them into the Q&A section. You'll see it on the screen, a button that says Q&A, and we'll get to them during the course of the conversation. So thank you so much, very sincerely from my part, and over to you, Claudia, to begin the discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ambassador Allison, for inviting me to be part of this celebration. I have to tell you that when you wrote me a couple of weeks ago, I realized that during about 8 years, I lived in front of a Catholic church. Its name is St. Brigid, but I never asked who St. Brigid was. So when you invited me to be here, I started reading about this amazing woman. So now she's one, she's included in my list of inspiring women for my life. So thank you very much for this opportunity. I'm so glad and more than honored to be here. And what a better way to celebrate this day than having a dialogue with these three amazing women you have invited. And Anderson, Mary Lawlor, and Mary Harney have been all pioneers on their own fields. So we have so much to learn from them. So let's go straight with the questions. And I want to start with you. You have been the first women from Ireland to reach so many important political positions. As the ambassador said, you were the first female to be the ambassador in the United States and also in the United Nations and also the European Union and among other embassies. I'm wondering if it happened because when you were a little girl or a teenager, you decided to be who you are in politics. So you worked strategically to do it, or if these opportunities were coming to you and you realize that this is very important, not only for your career, but for every woman in Ireland. So you did it in this outstanding way.
Well, good morning to everybody. Good morning from New York. Okay, I'm just checking there that I'm properly on. Good morning from blizzardy, snowbound New York. I would much prefer to be in Colombia. Thanks, Alison, for those lovely words of introduction. Great to meet you, Claudia, and to see again my good friends, the two Marys, and happy St. Bridget's Day to everybody. Well, it's an interesting question about my journey in the Irish Foreign Service. I would actually say, Claudia, directly in answer to your question, it was more the latter. It was challenges that I confronted along the way and had to find it within myself to respond to those challenges rather than something that was deep within me from the very beginning. How could I ever have imagined as a child, a young girl growing up in a small town in Ireland with parents who had never been to university, never having known anybody or understood what the diplomatic life was about, how could I even have created that ambition within myself at the time? So it was really a question of navigating the journey as you went along and dealing with the challenges. And I suppose my career, because it was a very long career, I joined the Foreign Service in late 1972. As you heard, I left in 2017. So there were 50 years that spanned 45 years, that spanned five really transformative decades in Ireland. And you take so much from what's happening around you. I mean, at the time I joined, it was a small Foreign Service representing a very conservative Catholic, still very Catholic, socially conservative country. We were just on the eve of joining the European Union. And then in the course of the career, so much changed. By the time I left, it was a totally different country, a much more progressive country, of course, a bigger Foreign Service now, but also, and this was critical, I think, to the opening up of opportunity, we were now a seasoned, experienced, very committed member of the European Union. And that changed a great deal over the decades. So I think I just, you know, I sort of, I wouldn't say wandered into the career, but there was a little bit of that. When I left university with a degree in history and politics, I joined the Foreign Service wanting to explore and figure out who I was and what my life could be. And so then I confronted the challenges, like I said. At the time I joined, there were very few women in the Foreign Service. Partly that was the legacy of what we call the marriage ban, this rule that existed until the time we joined the European Union, that the day you married was the day you retired from your career. So we didn't have role models, really. There were, you know, a few women, but very few role models. So you had to kind of figure it out yourself as you went along. And it meant that it was a male-conditioned, very male-oriented environment. It was really a man's world, and it was up to you to fit in as a woman. And that fitting in didn't always feel comfortable, and you just had to, as I said, figure it out as you went along, as the challenges came. Because there were so few women, I so often found myself being in the position of being the first to do this or that. So when I was posted abroad for the first time in 1976, I was the first married woman to be posted abroad. And they didn't want to give me a married officer's allowance. And so I had to find it, as still a very young woman, the courage within myself to mount a fight about that and insist I got the married officer's allowance, which I did. And that was the first, I think, stiffening of my backbone and realizing that there were issues that I really would have to fight on. So that began the first, I would say the first half of my career, the first 20 years before I became an ambassador. And mostly I just got on with it and did the very best I could. But there were moments when you really had to confront the inherent sexism that was part of the whole institution. And for example, in the early 80s, when I applied for and didn't get a posting as Consul General in Boston, the informal feedback I had was, well, Irish America is very macho and they're not really ready for a woman diplomat in that role. And I had to go and engage with and confront those issues. And, you know, there was also an early promotion that I didn't get. There was no competition. The decisions came to promote men from a male-only decision-making body. So again, I had to get these reality checks and decide how I was going to respond and deal with them and strengthen my resolve. And then there was the final half. I'm going through it pretty quickly because I'm conscious of your time. But the second half of my career as ambassador, and there I had five wonderful posts, very substantive, very challenging, very engaging, and a huge amount of satisfaction. But again, there were the challenges because, first of all, there were the generic challenges because women as ambassadors are still such a minority. When I went to Brussels, for example, as ambassador to the European Union, I was the first woman from any member state of the Union in over 45 years of history of the European Union. They had never had a woman permanent representative from any member state. So I had to, you know, find my way first with the all male colleagues in a 15 member union. Then I was the only woman when the union enlarged and we were 25 and I was chairing the group. So it's again, mustering yourself to face those challenges. And then even though things over the years had got a great deal better within my own foreign service and there were more women, there were still these occasions that, you know, you found yourself thinking, is it always going to be three steps forward and one step back? And for example, in 2008, there was an opening for the post of Secretary General, the top job in the department. I was an extremely seasoned ambassador, very experienced at this stage. I applied for it. Again, no competitive process. A man was appointed who was less experienced than I was. So again, trying to engage with the authorities and basically tell them what you thought about this and trying to move forward. And you know, even as late as 2014, when I was ambassador to the States, an incident, I didn't bother going into the details of it, but I found myself being portrayed in the Irish media as, you know, the ice queen and the diva, quote unquote, of the Department of Foreign Affairs. And you know, even it was so discouraging, comments from unattributed government sources saying I was, quote unquote, too big for my boots and referring to my Prada shoes, which I can assure you I've never had in my life. So, I mean, I think the challenge, and to finish up on this, I think the real challenge is to stay true to yourself and to do the job as you feel it ought to be done and not allow yourself be derailed or thrown off track by this kind of sexism that's going to be out there and going to try to reach you from time to time. And it's the challenge, I think, being finding that balance, celebrating and recognizing and embracing all of the undoubted progress, but never getting complacent about it. Knowing that the challenges will be there, that we've come a long way on the journey, but we're not there yet. So to finish where I began, Claudia, no, I could sometimes say that I found my courage along the way. I don't think I set out to be a crusader, but I always hated and responded and reacted to injustice as I saw it. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, along the way strengthened my resolve and my character. As I say, a long journey and we're not there yet.
Yeah. And but what do you think is the clue for you to use this you have in your soul or in your blood to have the courage to use it, to fight for your own career and to don't follow the rules, even though there were the rules at the time?
Well, I think I was very conditioned, I suppose, Claudia, by my time. Remember, even though the revolution of the 1960s came very late to Ireland, and we were still, I was at university from 1969 to 1972. So even though we were a bit behind the curve in Ireland, I still absorbed a lot of this sense of the 60s, that there needed to be equality and justice, and we all needed to have an equal opportunity. And that I had that feeling that we were on the cusp of change and that women were going to be in the vanguard of it. So I joined the Foreign Service in 1972, knowing the history, knowing the background, but feeling that we were now ready to assume our rightful place. So it never stopped shocking me when I encountered barriers or when I encountered sexism. And so there was, partly I think it was my upbringing and partly it was that conditioning of the late 60s. But that sense that we will overcome, and that I was definitely as well fortified by our membership of the European Union and by the opening of windows in Ireland, the new oxygen, the new air, the new confidence that came in. So part of it was within, I think I have a very strong inherent sense of justice, but part of it was the environment, the as I say, the atmospherics of so on, of the conditioning of the late 60s. And part of it was the confidence and the courage that Irish women got from their membership of the European Union. So I think it's always that combination, something from deep within you that is part of who you are. And some of it is the good fortune you have to be able to draw courage from the times and the sense of changing times.
I like your answer very much, because I think we have now an environment that is settled for women to fight for what they believe. So we have again that opportunity to go, you know, further in this fight for women's rights. Thank you. And now, Mary Harney, you also have a very exciting career on politics in your country. You actually were the first woman to be the Vice Prime Minister of Ireland. I know you have a specific word to mention it, to name it, but with this English, I cannot even pronounce that. I think it's something like Tánaiste.
That was an excellent pronunciation.
Okay. Okay, thank you. What I want from you is tell us about that journey, because I can imagine you surpassed so many obstacles. And I think the anecdotes about the way you face those, it's are very empowering for the women who are watching us. But listen to me, I know there are men connected here with us too. And I know from my experience writing my third book, which is Embrujas, there are many men who agree with gender equity, but they have to know what is their power to help balancing the ground on gender matters. It's not only to applaud women who are fighting for it, but doing something. So I think from your experience, you can share some anecdotes that help them to know what's their power.
Thanks, Claudia. And may I wish everybody a happy St. Bridget's Day. I actually went to a school called Cailleadh de Breida, which is the Irish for St. Bridget. So this was always a special day because we got the day off school, believe it or not, because it was St. Bridget's Day. And of course, it's supposed to be the start of spring. But as I look out my window here in Dublin, in Ireland, it doesn't look very like spring to me. It's more of a wintry, dark, dull day. And I would love to be, like Anne said, I'd love to be in Colombia. I had a fabulous holiday there. It's the last holiday I've had, actually, in January 2020. And I loved your country, and I can't wait to go back. And in fact, the painting behind me I bought in the market in Bogota. I was an accidental politician. I didn't set out to be a politician. I had intended becoming an accountant. But when I was in university, and like Anne, I was the first of my family to go to university. My parents did not have a university education. When I was in university, I was very involved in student debating and student politics. And as a result of that, I got appointed to the Senate by the Prime Minister. We have a provision in our constitution in Ireland that allows the Prime Minister of the day to appoint 11 people to the Senate. When I became a Member of Parliament in 1977, I was in my early 20s. The only woman that was there in her own right was Mary Robinson, our former first woman president. Every other woman that was in the Parliament was there by virtue of her relationship with a man. In other words, there were a lot of widows whose husbands had died, and they got elected to the position in the by-election, or there were daughters of former male holders of the position. So the Parliament was a very male-orientated place. Ireland, as Anne has just said, was a very conservative country. And I was determined to change things. But obviously, when you're appointed to the Senate, it's only for one term, and I had to get myself elected. And I first went for the local elections in my area. And the first big challenge I faced was getting selected, because it wasn't quite seen as a thing for a woman. So I had a major challenge getting selected. I had to do a lot of networking. I had to get a lot of my family and friends involved and a lot of my former school colleagues involved. And the number one was getting selected. The second thing was getting the finance together to fund a campaign, and it's much more difficult. It was much more difficult then for women than it is for men, because many women in Ireland didn't have careers outside their family, so they didn't have resources to support you. But one of the most helpful things was for me was having a male mentor, somebody that believed in me. And I think if women are to succeed, you have to work with men. You have to find male champions that believe in equality, that believe in women's participation, not just in politics, but in decision-making generally. They were rare, those men, in 1977 to 79, but there's more of them now.
Yeah.
And what I would say, you have to be pretty thick-skinned to be in politics, particularly now because of social media. References made to your appearance, to your dress. In fact, this very weekend, Chancellor Merkel, whom I greatly admire, stood down as the leader of our party after 18 years. And at the press conference, she was asked about the clothes she wore. She was asked about who does the housework in our house, who does the washing. And she replied and said, well, I'm not a model, so I'm not going to be talking about my clothes. And she said, why aren't you asking me about my successes and my failures? So even today, in a country like Germany, some journalists tend to, and some people tend to focus on women in a way they never would with a man. And I know from in Ireland now, there's about 22.5% of the people in our parliament are female. And I know many of them are subjected to an awful lot of abuse on social media, much more so than their male equivalents. So I would say a woman has to be more determined, has to be very resilient. You have to be motivated that you want to do it. I really enjoyed politics. I was interested in issues. I was determined not to get cul-de-sacked and just deal with what was perceived to be women's issues. Because sometimes you can be just put into a little pigeonhole and not expected to have views on the big political issues of the day or the economic issues or whatever. And I think that's very important. You have to believe in yourself. You have to want to be a politician. A bit like Anne, when you represented her country, you don't represent yourself in politics, you represent other people, and you must remain connected to those people. Tip O'Neill, the former speaker in America, once said, all politics is local. And it is a fact that politics is local. And in my early years in politics, there were no mobile phones, there was no internet. It was a contact business. You had to meet people, and that tended to be at the weekends and evenings. So politics can be very antisocial, especially if you're a young woman. When your friends are partying or getting married, you're going to meetings of the party, or you're going to residence meetings or meetings in your community. So I think right around the world, we see huge change. The pace of change and the magnitude of the change is truly inspiring. And we see so many now women leaders, prime ministers and leaders in countries that we could never have even dreamt of would be supportive of women. But I think for women that are interested in politics, my advice is go for it. It's a very rewarding career. It's a difficult career. It has its challenges, but it has huge rewards. And if you want to affect change in your society, a change at local level or national level, or maybe even at international level, working with others in politics can really help deliver change. And I've seen enormous change during my lifetime. The country I live in now is not the same country that I was in 1977 when I got involved in politics. There was no family planning in Ireland. There was no divorce. There was not many women working outside the home when they got married. There were no career opportunities really for women. It was kind of frowned upon. And I suppose what gave me the strength when things were difficult, and I had some very difficult experiences, what gave me the strength was the fact that I had a very good education. And that gives you confidence in a way I think you couldn't quite manage if you didn't have the benefit of good education. And I would say to everybody, having a good education, having an interest and a passion for change, standing up for what you believe in, as Anne said, being authentic and distinctive, and not trying to be like somebody else, be yourself. And role models, I think, are really important for women and men. If you don't see somebody in a role, it's hard to imagine that it's a role for you. I remember being in a school in my constituency a number of years ago, and the teacher asked the students, they were about 10 or 11 years of age, what the Tánaiste did, which is the deputy prime minister. And one little boy said, she is the wife of the Taoiseach, which is the prime minister. That's how he thought, what he thought the Tánaiste was. So I think it's somewhat easier for women now to see politics as an option right around the world. Much more harshly, and that doesn't just apply to politics. I think it's to men, friends of my business, friends of mine in the legal profession would say to me, it's a bit the same in every decision-making role. As you rise to the top, you tend to get some people feeling it's not quite the right thing to do, and you just have to be determined, as Anne was, to overcome that prejudice and pursue the course that you want for yourself. You've got to be ambitious. You mentioned I started a political party. I became very disillusioned with the party of which I was a member. And in the early 1980s and 1985, together with somebody else, we started a new political party in Ireland. And through that party, we were in government, and that's why I was the deputy prime minister. I was the leader of the smaller party in government. If I'd stayed in the bigger party, would that have happened? I doubt it at that point, because the bigger parties in Ireland tend to be very conservative. And we haven't had a woman leader yet of any of the main parties in Irish politics. Hopefully it will happen soon, but it hasn't happened yet. We currently have four women in the Irish government. There's 15 members of the government, four of them are women, and that's great progress. In recent years, we've had great progress. I would say to any woman, don't allow yourself to be a token. Sometimes if there's just women there, it's perceived to be tokenism. You need a critical mass of women in order to affect change. And I enjoyed my career in politics. There were a lot of lows, an awful lot of lows. And it's your friends and your family that carry you through those low points. And I would always advise any young woman, whether it's in politics or elsewhere, and I actually act as a mentor to two young women who want to pursue a career in politics. I think having a mentor, somebody that you can take advice from, somebody that doesn't feel threatened by you, somebody that is genuinely interested in you, somebody that has more experience than you, I would always advise people to find a mentor, because that was invaluable to me, certainly, particularly at difficult points in my career, to just have somebody that I could talk to and get their advice. And you mightn't follow their advice, but it was very good to hear it.
What a lot of practical message and lessons, Mary. Thank you very much. And let me tell you, here in Colombia, at the end of last year, a law was approved to force the political parties to include women on their lists for next elections in at least 50%. I would like you to know, what do you think about quotas? Because the situation here in Colombia is kind of similar to the situation in Ireland. There are no so many women participating in the in the parliament. What do you think about quotas, or what do you think can we do to increase the participation of women in politics?
I have mixed views about quotas, to be honest with you. In Ireland now, we have a system whereby the funding of the party is dependent on having at least 30% women, and that's going to go up to 40% on the ticket to go forward to the be voted on. It hasn't really, whilst it's had an impact on the number of women being selected, it hasn't really had an impact on the number of women being elected. I think a much more powerful tool is to work through persuasion of women to get involved in politics, because what's happened with the system in Ireland is parties tend to select women for the ticket that really haven't a chance of being elected, if you understand me. So at the end of the day, you have to be elected by the people. So I think we need role models. We need a critical mass of people in the media, for example, to get the message across of how important it is for objective decision making to have a critical mass of women and men making the decisions, because otherwise you do not get, in my opinion, objective and good decisions if you lack either gender in the decision-making process. And it goes beyond gender into diversity too. So I think it's a question of persuasion. It's a question of self-motivation. Sometimes the barriers, women erect the barriers themselves. They feel politics is not for them. When I was Minister for Health for 6 years, as Alison mentioned earlier, health is almost 90% female occupation now. Yet nurses and doctors were represented by men. So the people that came to lobby me for the interests of nurses and doctors tended to be men. So sometimes women opt out of what they call that political side of life. They do their job, they work hard, but where there's extra activity involved, they sometimes don't feel it's for them. And I've discussed this very often with women, and they're sometimes they feel that politics, they don't like what they see of politics through the media. They feel it's too aggressive, it's too combative, it's not really for them. And I just think we need to persuade key women at local level in the first instance, because politics, you know, is, as I said earlier, very much about local issues as much as it is about national issues. We just need to motivate sufficient number of women who have an interest, who have a passion, who want to be politicians. If you don't want to be a politician and you haven't got a passion for it, there's no point in trying to persuade you. When I was leader of my party, we always had 40%, 50%, in fact, women representatives in our parliament. Now, we were small numbers, and one of my male colleagues, Anne and Ambassador Milton would know this person, Michael McDool was his name. He was one of my male colleagues. He's still a member of the parliament in Ireland. He once said to me, the way things are going in this party, we're going to need quotas for men, because he felt that we were getting a bit overwhelmed with the number of women. And that was because I was very keen to get women involved and go and have conversations with them and encourage them and put support, whether it was helping them to get people to support them in their constituency that would canvass for them, or people that would might raise money for them. These kind of practical issues very often make the difference between success and failure. So identify those that have the interest and then put resources behind them to help them break through the barriers, such as financial barriers or having enough people to campaign for them, etc.
Thank you, Mary. I think we can go deeper with this matter. I'm so interested in, because one of the points for many women to avoid politics is they are scary about that. So for the next intervention from you, I want you to talk about that, how to manage.
It's not for the
emotion.
Faint-hearted. I don't know if you understand faint-hearted. It's not for the weak or faint-hearted, because your career is very public. One of the things that used to really upset my parents was when they would read bad stories about me in the media. Or if my mother once read a story that I should cut my hair and lose weight and wear different clothes. These things used to really upset my parents. I actually got used to it. That sounds incredible, but you do. I think it's even harder now with social media, where you have so many anonymous commentators commenting on people. And I know from, as I said earlier, from some of my friends in the current parliament, many of them find it really difficult to see the stuff they have to see on social media. And I do believe, separate to this discussion. We need to regulate social media because it can cause a lot of damage to people and a lot of hurt and upset.
Yes, media, we as journalists have many things to learn in the way we cover the careers of women, because we can frustrate them in some cases. Thank you, Mary. Now we have Mary Lawlor here with us too. Mary, thank you for being here, for connecting with us. You're there? Yeah. Okay, I see you now. Mary, being the United Nations Special Rapporteur for Human Rights Defenders, make you, you know very well the challenges that those who advocate for others have to face. And among them are feminists. What can you tell us about being a woman who fights for the rights of other women and live with this satisfaction of reaching some important goals, maybe laws in your country, but at the same time knowing that it doesn't mean that those rights spread automatically to every woman around the world?
Well, I don't really know what to say to you, but I suppose I think the work of human rights defenders, those who are fighting for the rights of other people, is extremely important. And I think that women human rights defenders who fight for the rights of women are doubly discriminated against. They are targeted for who they are and for what they do. So it's twice, they face the same kind of threats as their male colleagues, but they have extra threats because they are women. For me, I think it's I suppose, you know, when you look back on, as Anne and Mary were saying, you know, a bit on how Ireland has developed. I mean, when my mother had to resign when she got married, she was a doctor. She had to resign when she got married because that was the law. She got no pension. There was a bar, you couldn't have a barring order in Ireland at the time if your partner was violent. You couldn't serve on a jury. And of course, you know, everything, there was no separation between church and state, and there's the access to information, access to contraception, access to abortion, reproductive rights, and equal marriage was just, they were taboo subjects. And there were some phenomenal women around at the time. There was a woman called Hilda Tweedy who set up the commission on the status of women. And I was really shy at the time. And I remember they were having a meeting upstairs in a room upstairs in one of the streets. And I walked up and down. It was a voluntary organization. I walked up and down and I couldn't pluck up the courage to go in that day. But they were phenomenal. They really pushed forward the beginnings of a feminist movement in Ireland. And there were some really funny stories. I mean, 32 of them went into a pub one day, one evening for a drink, and they ordered 32 brandies. And then they asked for a pint. Now, women weren't served pints in bars at that time. So they asked for a pint of beer. And the bartender said, no, women aren't served pints. And they said, well, we're not paying for the 32 brandies unless you give us a pint. So of course the bartender gave them a pint because he didn't want 32 brandies to go astray. But for me, I think it was a gradual realization that the people who build civil and just societies are human rights defenders. They're the ones that will eventually prevail. I mean, if you look back to Latin America in the 70s, there were so many military dictatorships everywhere. And yet, even at that time, you had women organizing, like, for example, the grandmothers of La Plaza de Mayo, who who were looking for their disappeared grandchildren. And in Colombia today, you have so many really good women's organizations that work for the rights of women, like the OFP in Barranca, a place I visited. And when I went there, they had a steel door across the office because of the threats that they faced every day. And then you have the organization of the feminist organization of we call them the Reds. I don't know what the Red Nacional de Mujeres or something like that. And there's many other, and they're all working day in, day out for the rights of women. So for me, I think it's just about what do you do, you know, when you see injustice? And Anne was talking there, and Anne actually was the first person who, when I set up Frontline Defenders, an organization that worked to protect human rights defenders at risk, Anne was the ambassador in Geneva. And she was very kind to me. I had just come to Geneva to the Human Rights Council, and she was the ambassador, the Irish ambassador, and she really helped. And in fact, when she won European, I can't remember what the title was, Anna, was it European Parliamentarian of the Year?
Diplomat of the Year,
sorry, yeah, of course. She gave her prize money to Frontline Defenders. I couldn't believe it. But I think if once you know about injustice, and it is a core belief in you, that you should be trying to make the world a little bit more civilized, then you really don't have a choice. I always remember this Irish poet, Seamus Heaney, who was really fantastic. And he was interviewed one day, and he said he believed that we were put here to make the world a bit more civilized. And I love that we were put here to make the world a bit more civilized, but you have to choose it every day. And as Mary said, it can be very difficult in politics. And as Anne said, it can be very difficult. So it is a choice that every day you have to choose to make the world a bit more civilized.
Mm. Mary, thank you. Now that you mentioned the Red Nacional de Mujeres, La Red, I would like you to add something regarding the role of women to promote peace and to avoid conflict. I ask this because from my second book, Forgiving the Unforgivable, I decided to have a chapter specifically dedicated to women because it amazed me how many women that had suffered violence, being victims or perpetrators, are able to manage their emotions, even the desire for revenge, and to switch it into other emotions that not only give peace from themselves, but also for their families and their communities. Would you like to add something on the role of women to promote peace?
Yeah, I think it's in Colombia, I think particularly women, you see women as the main promoters in many ways of peace. And it's not just those organizations. There's the Vigils for Peace in Colombia. You know, that I can't pronounce it, Mesa de Trabajo Mujer El Conflicto Armada on Colombia, but there's so many of them. But I think women, because they are primary caregivers, very often you see it's women that are the primary caregivers to children. And they look to the future, I think, and the future they want to see for their children. So they get involved in trying to create a future that will be better for their children. And I think that's why you see a lot of women getting involved in human rights work, in trying to advance the rights of women and trying to create peaceful environments where children can develop.
Mm, thank you. Thank you very much, Mary Lawlor. Well, what about having some minutes to think about these important lessons and reflections from these amazing women? And let's do it while we listen at our talented musician Katie James, who is ready to share with us a song. I think it's related with an Irish woman. Katie, it's a pleasure to meet you, and please tell us about this song and let's enjoy your music.
Hello, Claudia, and hello, everyone. It's an honor for me to be here amongst all these amazing women. I'm going to sing a traditional Irish song called She Moved Through the Fair. I'm Irish, but I've lived in Colombia most of my life. But Irish music is definitely one of the things that has stayed with me, and I've listened to it from a very early age. So here it goes. She moved through the fairs. My young love said to me, my mother won't mind, and my father won't slight you for your lack of kind. And she stepped away from me, and this she did say, it will not be long left till our wedding day.
Wow, what a lovely performance, Katie. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Very, very
nice. I think we will have some minutes at the end to enjoy your music again. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, let's
go back to our panelists. And I'm coming to you again because you have been in Colombia, as Ambassador mentioned earlier. And I think last time was last January. That's why I want you to tell us, what do you think about the status of women in Colombia and also in Latin America, because you know the region, compared with how is it in Ireland?
Well, I've been twice, Claudia, in Colombia, as you mentioned. Once, in both visits, I was there in my capacity as a member of the UN Advisory Group on Peacebuilding. I found particularly interesting, I think, the first visit, because not alone did we spend a lot of time in Bogota, but we went to Choco in the Northwest and we visited projects on the ground there. So it was an opportunity to see it firsthand, the challenges, but also the courage and the resilience of the local people and what they're facing, and particularly, of course, the women. But two visits doesn't make me an expert, and I'm not pretending to be an expert, but I have tried to follow to some degree what's been happening in Colombia. And if you compare the situation for women in Colombia and Ireland, we each have come a long way. We can learn a lot, I think, from each other. In the case of Colombia, you're obviously, you know this well, I'm sure, Claudia, but your 2016 peace agreement is regarded as a model internationally for a gender-inclusive peace agreement. The provisions of your peace agreement are seen globally as a model, and they're well ahead of, for example, what we had in our Good Friday Agreement in 1998 that addressed the conflict in Northern Ireland. And you have very good legislation on your books, and it was impressive, for example, in 2018, when President Duque announced his gender-balanced cabinet. We're still far from that in Ireland. You heard Mary talk about the numbers in our cabinet. So yes, there are definitely interesting things happening in Colombia. But I think you also have to look at the daily lived reality of women's lives and not just what's on the statute books. And I think there, of course, Colombia, you face particular challenges. You're in the early aftermath of your peace agreement and the residue of your conflict, of course, is still there. The peace agreement, excellent as it is on paper, it's still very much work in progress, and a lot of the implementation is still outstanding. So that's a challenge. I think also more generally, and this is true of Latin America as well as Colombia, I think the position of women in a society, and I'm talking here, as I say, about the daily lived reality of women's lives, it's very reflective of the socioeconomic situation in that society. And I think, you know, Ireland is a richer country than Colombia, but also the issue of economic inequality is very important. And, you know, we're certainly not, we're far from perfect in Ireland, and here in the United States, where I am at the moment, of course, there's rampant economic inequality. But it remains the case that Latin America is the most unequal region in the world. And I think when there is economic inequality in a society, that often has a disproportionate impact on women. So as I say, I think in certain respects, there is so much to be impressed about what's happening in Colombia, and to acknowledge the progress that is undoubtedly being made. But there are still challenges, of course, as there are for us in Ireland.
Thank you, Anne. We are getting many questions from the audience, so let's go to some of them. But first, Mary Harney, I would like you to continue with the conversation we had earlier about how to overcome fear, because actually some of the questions from the audience are related with that. How can we make that women are more willing to participate in politics? And I think it goes parallel with overcoming the fears. Maybe your answer is just do it, but for many women, it could be like, how?
Yes, and it's easier said than done, as they say. I think, well, first of all, individual women have to want to be involved in politics. You know, they have to be self-motivated to want to get involved in politics. I think the media have a role to encourage that, and to encourage the political parties to support women and to select women. I know you have your presidential elections coming up, and it may be an opportunity for some of the existing women to be role models and mentor other women and encourage them, because the numbers will increase, I think, very gradually, which is also the case in Ireland. In fact, we went slightly back at the last election in Ireland last year. The numbers were reduced somewhat, which was very disappointing. a lot of new women were elected, but a lot of existing women lost their seats, unfortunately. If there's a swing against your party, it takes out a lot of people, not just men, it takes out women as well. So it's been very hard to make significant progress in Ireland, even with what I said earlier, the financial incentive for political parties to choose women. But I think the media have a role to play. I think academia sometimes has a role to play. Very often women that get involved in politics around the world come from, women and men, come from an academic background, particularly in countries that are struggling to implement a peace process, such as you are in Colombia, or in a country where there are human rights challenges, etc. Very often you will find that the impetus for change can come from people from the university sector. So I think it's a question of identifying key individuals and putting resources, support behind them. I don't know who the personalities are in Colombia, but I'm quite certain they're known to those of you that live there. And it may well be a question of just identifying a few key individuals that could make an impact and are up for the challenge. And it's a question of, you know, you can't make somebody a politician if they don't want to be involved in politics. So it's a question of identifying those that want to affect change. I would always say politics is difficult, it's challenging, but it's very rewarding. And there's a great buzz that comes from politics because you tend to feel that you're at the center of what's happening. Maybe you need a certain ego to be involved in politics. But it is a fact that people involved in politics, generally speaking, very few people voluntarily resign or retire from politics until they come of an age when they've served for too long. I was in politics for 34 years, so it was time to move on and do other things. But generally speaking, people don't opt out that often. Very few people opt out in my experience because they do enjoy it. But that's a question of identifying the people for which politics is suitable. And you know who they are, Claudia, I'm sure, and maybe you can profile them and help them and get them publicity and get teams of people. I don't mean you personally, I mean people like you can help identify them and put the support in their way. Can I just say, I think one of the good ways of getting a profile with a view to being elected is to become a bit of an expert in a particular area. I've seen that now in Ireland where some key women develop an expertise and then they're invited to get involved in politics by the different parties. So it could be climate change, it could be some foreign policy issue or domestic policy issue, it could be an environmental issue, it could be some social issues, human rights, whatever it might be. Parties are crying out for people that can bring expertise to the table. And I think it is a very good way of raising your profile and encouraging political parties to probably pay attention to you.
Yeah, it's a very good idea as, you know, at this time, when we have a year and a half for the next presidential election, we just have one woman who is a pre-candidate, which is the current vice president of the country. The rest of the pre-candidates are like 20 men. So that idea is so welcome because media could help a lot to profile that women and to, you know, to incentive them to try. Thank you, Mary. And now, Mary Lawlor, and maybe at this diplomatic level, Colombia and Ireland could work together in some projects to test what works better for having more women participating in politics. Why not, Ambassador Alison? Maybe we can talk about that later. Now, Mary Lawlor, I think it's so important to develop skills to manage those situations that some people think they are just little obstacles on the career of a woman, but they are not little when we are talking about sexual harassment or unconscious biases. It can frustrate a career and it can turn a promising life into not an exciting one. What do you want to share from your experience in human rights that helps to develop that skills to surpass that difficulties?
I suppose, you know, if you are working in a challenging environment where there is a historical context of both drugs and of armed conflict, and also whereby there are structural problems with equality and poverty. I think that the best way forward is, first of all, to start with early childhood, and for women to bring their children up not to be stereotyped, because I do think that stereotyping is a particular difficulty when it comes to, you know, what women feel they are capable of. And as the other said, you know, access to education is vital. And gender equality is one, it's the SDG 5, I think, in the sustainable goals. And it's not just a fundamental human right, it's a necessary foundation for peaceful, prosperous, and a sustainable world. So for me, what I would do if I was in that situation, I would look around and see who else was, who would be an ally. Were there organizations or were there individuals that would be, that I could join with to develop a common goal and a common understanding of what is needed to see that goal realized. Because around the world, you see people mobilizing to achieve specific goals. And also building a network helps protect you as well yourself. If you are in some way under threat, either within the family or outside of the family. So having a network of support is really important. So I think that, you know, if you create a network and mobilize with like-minded individuals and people, you can look jointly then for laws and practices that will improve, you know, rights. And you can see all over the world that the advances in women's rights have come through really feminist movements around the world and women's rights movements around the world. And you saw it in Ireland. I mean, you know, when we had just lately, a couple of, I don't know how long ago it is, everything feels for just nearer to me, but the abortion referendum here. I mean, even 10 years ago, that would have been unheard of, that there would have been access to reproductive health here. But what happened was all the women's groups got together, all the individuals got together, and they told their stories, and they had all these different groups. They had doctors, there was, you know, I was at meetings, for example, where a doctor said that she felt that she had to have an abortion because she already had a child with problems, and her other child had this fetal disease. And they told the stories about why they needed access to abortion. And it was the same when it was equal marriage. They brought it into society in a way that made it all very normal. And I think it's about normalizing situations that seem as if they're out there and that are just a women's issue, or it goes against the society to be looking for this, but to educate society and bring society along with you through mobilizing and through creating networks, that can have a very positive effect. And then, of course, politicians will listen. You know, if there is a groundswell of opinion, politicians will listen.
Mm. Thank you very much, Mary. Networks are so important always. And let's take some questions from the audience. This one is actually for you. while this through this hurtado from Movimiento de Mujeres Negras Afrocolombianas, the movement of Black women from Colombia, she's asking, what are the strategies we can develop as women from different backgrounds and ethnicities to promote women's rights in this peace context?
Well, it really does get back to what I was just saying. I mean, I have talked to a lot of Afro-Colombian women, and I think that the organizations are strong. I think that there is huge racism against them. And I think the women human rights defenders, they are having to move because they are in danger. So I know somebody I spoke to recently is literally moving from house to house because they're in danger and they can't stay where they are, even with COVID. And that's another thing that has happened. COVID has made the situation of women human rights defenders much more difficult because they can't move and they're sitting targets. But I think that the key is to try and, you know, have your vision, make a plan and try and execute that plan. Look at what your goals are. Look at how you're going to get there. See who you need to help you along the way. See who will block these goals. And then see who's in the middle. You know, there are always people who are persuadable. There's no point in going after the blockers because they're never going to come along with you. Your allies will support you. The blockers won't ever support you. But the ones in the middle, if you can persuade them, then, you know, you will develop your network and increase your mobilization. So I would say that would be my approach. That's what I would say to that question, more or less.
Thank you. Thank you, Mary. Now, Claudia Ferrufino would like to know, what's the opinion of the other two panelists, I mean, Anne Anderson and Mary Lawlor, on regarding with quotas, Anne? We can't hear you. Please open your mic. Yeah.
The quota question is one where there has actually been an evolution of my thinking over the years. I listened very carefully to what Mary Harney was saying in answer to the question earlier about the importance of persuasion and so on. But I agree that, of course, quotas aren't the answer to everything. But I have to say that I do feel ultimately quotas do concentrate the mind. And the journey for women, it has been so long and the progress so slow and the ground still to be covered is so challenging that I have come to the view that quotas do play an important part in accelerating progress. Because when I look back, I mentioned the spirit in which I joined the Foreign Service in 1972. And if anybody had told me then that 45 years later, at the time that I was retiring, that we would be still struggling so much with these issues, that we would still be so far away from 50% equality, I wouldn't have believed them. I thought then we were on the cusp of change. And through all the years, you know, I understood the progress, I welcomed it, I heard about the pipelines, I believed in the pipelines, and I found the pipelines that were supposed to take women to the top, they kept leaking, you kept losing the women, the pyramidical structure remained very pyramidical. And for example, now, part of what I do, you know, I mentioned my work with the UN and so on, but I'm also on a corporate board. And while the 30% quota of women on corporate boards, it hasn't become mandatory, but it is very much something talked about. It's very much companies feel they have to live up to, that there's a reputational cost if they don't have 30% women on boards. And I've seen how it has driven the thinking within corporate boards, that they go out in a more determined and more focused way to recruit women to the boards because they don't want to incur this reputational damage about not having the 30%. So whether they're formal legal quotas or aspirational, whatever, I think we need to either have them or hold the threat of quotas over people, because they do concentrate the mind. And otherwise you think, yes, we're on the journey, but how long, Lord, how long? The journey has been too slow. The progress has been real, but in my view, too slow. So I have come over the years to have a more positive view of quotas than I would have had early on in my journey.
Thank you. And what about you, Mary Lawlor? We can't hear you.
I mean, my first position would be, as Mary Harney said, to try and persuade women. But there are so many barriers to women already that I'm a firm believer in quotas. Because I don't think, to be honest, if you look at the development of gender equality over the years and its lack and the lack of gender equality in so many places, I don't like to say it, but basically those in power are not going to embrace it. You know, it's not something, and you even see it in NGOs, in some NGOs in Latin America, for example. The people at the top of the NGOs are men, and they are the ones that want to come to all the meetings. And when I say to them, no, I want, I'm taking a woman, it seems as if it's something that shouldn't have been considered. So I think that from a rights point of view, I think quotas are very important, because they are not going to be wholeheartedly embraced or voluntarily embraced.
Mm. Thank you, Mary. Mary Harney, I think this question works for you. I don't know if this is for you or not, but the question from Julie de Rivero is, how much do you think we have to fight our own internalized barriers, those that women internalize, on top of those society places upon us? Please open your mic. Mary, I think we missed her a moment. Okay, so maybe Anne or Mary Lawlor want to answer this question?
Right, well, I'd be a poor substitute for Mary Harney, but until Mary is back online. I've always thought that women are dealing with three sets of barriers, the internal ones, the workplace ones, and the societal ones. And all three sets of barriers have to be addressed. And it's not, you know, you hear all the time about women's confidence issues and the ambition gap and all of that. And it's all very real, but I'm always prefacing my remarks with, it's not all on women. We have to work on ourselves, but it has to happen in tandem with what's happening in the wider society and the workplace. But yes, I mean, I think like everybody I've ever engaged with, any woman I've ever engaged with, you hear the same challenges that they faced within themselves, the confidence issues, the perfectionism, the constantly re-examining your performance to see, is it good enough? The reticence to speak up in public because you think maybe what you're going to say isn't sufficiently worthwhile to engage everybody's attention. So you have to work on yourself. And I've read a lot of the books, I've talked to other women, I've really tried to work on it over the years, but it's, as I said, because Mary I see is back now, I've always accompanied that with reminding myself and reminding other women, it's not all on us, because there are some people out there who would like you to believe that if women haven't achieved the positions they should have, it's something wrong with women, that it's an inherent kind of reticence and discretion and lack of ambition and confidence on women's part. And if we just go and train ourselves to be more ready to seize opportunities, everything will be okay. That's not the narrative. That's not true. So yes, in that wider context, we have work to do on ourselves. So back to Mary Harney now, too, the question.
Yeah, yeah. Mary, go ahead, please.
I think sometimes the barriers are self-imposed in that women, maybe it's not that they don't see themselves in that role, that they're not interested. I think I mentioned earlier when I was Minister for Health, the nursing profession, for example, in Ireland is over 90% female. Yet the people that came to lobby me on behalf of nurses were men. And similarly with doctors. And you very often find that women opt out of what's broadly described as the politics of the profession or the politics of the organization. In relation to quotas, unless you have quotas of the number of quotas in relation to who's going to be elected, it's not certainly in Ireland so far in its early days having an impact. The quotas that you have to have 30% women candidates in order to get a certain financial support. We've had 30% from all the parties, but unfortunately it hasn't increased the numbers. And in the most recent election, the numbers reduced. So I think we have to go beyond that. There's a wonderful organization in Ireland called Women for Election that I'm very involved in. And this is an NGO. They've got some government support, some EU support, and I think maybe some UN support at one point. By support, I mean financial support. And they now train women. So they and I've been involved in some of their training programs, as other politicians have. And the women that are interested in pursuing a career in politics, they go on a training course, they learn how to organize a campaign, they learn about networking, they learn about communications, building an online campaign. You can successfully, notwithstanding the net said about social media, it is easier to build a campaign on social media. And it's been really, really beneficial. And a number of the women in the current parliament in Ireland have come through those programs. It's early days, but there may be learnings there for Colombia from this organization called Women for Election. And a lot of us strongly support them. And I know it's certainly having an impact because sometimes women feel, I know from friends of mine in the past, they would say, oh, I'd love to do it, but it's not for me, or I'd be too nervous getting up to speak, or I wouldn't know what to say, or I wouldn't know how to deal with the media, etc. And that's a nervousness, really, or a lack of confidence. Mm. And sometimes an organization or a support group that can help you through some of those identifiable barriers can be very helpful in encouraging you to move forward and to go forward. But let's face it, when I was in politics, I rarely ever heard men worried about their children. I constantly heard my female colleagues worried that they were taking time away from their children, particularly if they weren't from the capital where the parliament was meeting, if they had to travel, quite a distance and be away from home, maybe 3 or 4 nights per week. So I'm afraid women still have the children, and women, as a result of that, tend to worry more about the impact something like a political career, which involves you being away from home, may have on your family. And that is just the reality. It is a fact, I think.
I think it is very important, Mary, because I think women need to improve the way we choose our partners for life. It's a difference when you have a good selection. It's important to work on it.
Yes. Well, there are more new age men around now than there were. I see a lot more men in Ireland out wheeling their children during COVID than I would have seen 25 years ago, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So it's improving.
Yeah. It's improving, yes. Okay, we are running out of time. I'm sorry, we cannot take very interesting questions that we have collected from our audience, but thank you for sending us these questions. And thank you to our busy panelists to make the time to be with us today in this celebration. We have learned a lot from you. I know now every of us has a new skill to promote gender equity. So it's been very important to be here together. And thank you, Ambassador, again for this invitation. It's been an honor for me. And as we mentioned earlier, we have time to close with a song from Katie James again, who prepared a surprise for us. So let's enjoy Katie and have a good rest of the day. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Claudia.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you so much, Claudia. Thank you, everyone, again. Well, I can't speak much about politics, but as a musician, actually, the last issue there, I was thinking about it recently because as a woman, recently I've been facing the question about children or not children. And so people ask me, okay, if you have a child, will you have to interrupt your career, your musical career? And I don't think that's a question that would be asked to a man. So yeah, we still have a long way to go. I want to sing one of my own songs. That it's a love song, but it's a love song about embracing a woman in her totality, because we are gentle, but we are also strong, and we can be fragile, but we are powerful. So this song is Todo o Nada in Spanish.
Mi llanto, somos tantas cosas, tomado todo nada. No te enamores de mi dulzura, también soy amarga, somos tantas cosas, tomado todo nada. Yo amo tu silencio y me enamora tu voz. Tú, mi dicha y mi tormenta, quiero vivir las dos. No te enamores de mi suavidad, si te asusta mi fuerza, somos tantas cosas, tómalo todo nada. Fragilidad, somos tantas cosas, tómalo todo nada. Yo amo tu silencio y me enamora.
Muchas gracias, Katie. Gracias a todos por estar con nosotros. Mil, mil gracias a los panelistas, a Claudia, a Katie, Anne, y los dos Marys. Mil, mil gracias. Thank you so much, everybody, for being with us. And a very happy St. Patrick's Day. Celebrate the wonderfulness of being
Bridget's.
A woman. Indeed. Oh, St. Bridget's Day. Apologies. The more important patron saint. Happy St. Bridget's Day, everybody.
Thanks, Alison.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, folks. Thank you so much.